Good morning and welcome. We're on lesson number 2 in the book of Romans. And each week I'm planning on having a handout. So if you didn't get your handout this morning, there should be some scattered at the 3 doors. So make sure you get one of that for your books. And if you didn't get a book last week, there's some extra 3-ring binders that are updated for you as well. I have a good friend. His name is Gary Woodward. He and his wife Jackie live here in Franklin. Gary is a nurse that works in Nashville, and the very unit he worked with is now trying to take care of him. He has COVID. They attend at the Methodist Church here in Franklin, and Gary's not doing so well. He and I both went to Auburn. We played ball together. He was left-handed, and he would come in relief with me quite a bit, and I'd go in relief with him. We had a lot of good time in high school, and he's just a good friend, and I hope you all will remember him in your prayers this week as he's fighting this. Let's just have a quick prayer for him this morning. Holy Father, we thank you for blessing us today, and we're grateful for the avenue of prayer, and we believe in prayer, and we just earnestly pray and plead this morning that you'll be with Gary and help him to recover quickly. Help him to make a rapid turnaround in his fight for this. And bless his sweet wife and be with his daughters, their daughters. And may we be an encouragement to them. And Father, may we continue to be as safe as we can in this unusual time. And help us as we battle this. Give us strength. Help us to remain positive and not get down with this, but to continue to fight strong. Help us to be an avenue of encouragement for those that have this COVID. Bless us with the insight, Lord, as to how to do things, how to show us the wisdom, Father, in dealing with all of this. But above all, help us to be a prayerful people and a grateful people. And we just, again, ask that you be with this family. In Christ's name, amen. If I put this mic on, like I'm supposed to wear it, now, how about that? Okay, so we're in the book of Romans. Last week we began with the introduction. I didn't completely get through the introduction, but I am going to move on. With the notes that you'll be able to take and with the things that we're putting in the Bible, in the binder, you should be able to carry on from week to week. So if we don't get completely finished with something, it gives you an avenue to go home and to study and hopefully you go write your own commentary on the book of Romans. Next to Jesus Christ, I don't know of anybody that made a greater impact on the world than did the Apostle Paul. He wrote most of the New Testament. He established churches in the Roman Empire. He established churches at Athens, Derbe, Corinth, Iconium, Lystra. And so he was such a great man of God. And so today I'll look at, I would like for us to get an insight into his life and what it takes to make an impact in the world. You know, the Bible tells us that we're to be a salt of the earth and a light of the world. I'm sort of getting a feedback. Are y'all hearing it? We're shorthanded today. Some of the folks that normally help us aren't here. And so if somebody doesn't mind, if you'd go out and unfortunately Stephen is shorthanded in Sunday school, So just tell him when he can take a break, Mike, if he could come and adjust this for us, I'd appreciate it. Thank you. And then also, Paul, we were talking about salt of the earth and being light of the world. Paul wrote for us in Romans 12, "Therefore I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Here's what the problem is. I'm on two mics. So when Kirby comes in that back door, you tell him I'm on two mics and to turn this one off, please. Thanks. So when we look at the book of Romans, when we look at the first 17 verses, basically what we're doing is looking at an autobiography of Paul. Paul talks about himself. Now, he talks about himself in the other books, but he doesn't spend as much time in the shorter epistles. But since he hadn't been to Rome, he spends more time explaining who he is and giving them more insight. So today, what we're going to do is talk about Paul, the man, Paul's message, Paul's ministry, and Paul's motivation. Four things, if we have enough time to do that. Paul serves as a model for us. And so let's learn all we can and be all we can be and help us as we look at this book, each of us. I hope as we look at this, it'll help us to be better communicators for the gospel of Jesus Christ as he was. As a matter of fact, if I had to title this morning's lesson, I would title it "The Gospel According to Paul." Well, someone might say, "Well, I didn't know Paul wrote a gospel." Well, if you look at the first 17 verses, he wrote the word gospel four different times. Verse 1, verse 2, verse 9, and verse 16. So he did write a gospel, per se. And in the New Testament, you know, letters were normally short. You know, paper was hard to come by. Thank you, Scott. That really works well. Thank you. Paper was expensive. It was even more expensive when it was written on animal skin, so they didn't have the luxury that we do today in writing letters. The average letter at that particular time that Paul wrote would normally have about 150 words. Cicero, when he wrote his treatise at that particular time, had 4,500 words, and that was considered to be extremely lengthy. But yet, when Paul writes the book of Romans, he uses 7,100 words, so he used a lot of paper. And he had a lot to say. It was an important letter. In the first lesson, when we were talking about the introduction, I shared with you what some of the scholars had to say about Paul. But one more that I want to share with you was written by Gotti, who was a famous Swiss commentator. He said, "Every great revival ever started in history could somehow be related to this book." So the more we get into this book, I think we'll have a better understanding of that. So this morning, let's begin then with Paul, the man. Paul begins in verse 1. He says, "Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God." Paul begins by calling himself a servant of Christ. A servant of Christ. He was born a free man, but he calls himself a servant. And you know, the fact probably is we're all servants. We all serve something. To whom are we a servant? You know, Bob Dylan, when he wrote his song, you've got to serve somebody. We probably do, whether it's God or devil or someone or something. We probably serve someone. And the fact of the matter is, when you look at the life of Paul, he had changed masters. And we do. You know, when we obey the gospel of Christ, we change masters. Paul had been a servant of sin. He had been a servant to legalism, been a servant to Judaism, been a Pharisee, a chief of Pharisees. And so he changed masters. Now he is a servant of Jesus Christ. And in John chapter 8, verse 34, Jesus said, "Very truly, I tell you, anyone who sins is a slave to sin." So see, we are a servant, a slave to something. And then he says, "I've called thee an apostle." God's army is not a volunteer army. We're all commissioned. All of us are. We're not serving God, A-W-O-L. We may not be called to be an apostle, but we are called to use our gifts and to use them wisely. And we all have different gifts. And isn't that wonderful? And we're called to use them. And then he says that he's set apart for the gospel of God. The word set apart is from the Greek word aphorizo, which we get the word, English word horizon, which literally means streamlined or narrowed down. Paul's saying, this is my one thing. I'm set apart. He said, I'm a specialist. And we're used to the word specialist, because today if we go to a doctor and they find something wrong with us, and most all the time we find ourselves going to specialists. You know, it used to be when I was little, we'd go to the doctor, he could treat you for anything, but that's not the way it works anymore. Once you sort of find out what you have, you go see a specialist and you're treated. Well, Paul says, I'm set apart. I'm a specialist. He said, this is one thing. This is my one thing. This is what I focused on. I'm good in this area. This is why I'm set apart. And I'm a specialist in the gospel of Christ. And this is the theme of his life. And that's sort of what we're going to look at today. Now, I know this is going to tell my age, but you remember that old Western have gun travel? And the guy by the name of Paladin that was in there? Well, all sort of like have gospel will travel. He does. And of course, we read of his missionary journeys and we read of the churches that he started. And that's sort of what he had gospel, and he traveled and he taught it. And he taught it well. So now let's look at his message. Look at verse 2. The gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So he's set apart, he's the specialist, and here's the message. The message is the gospel he promised. The gospel was promised beforehand. So what does the gospel mean? Well, the gospel means good news. Good news. We all like good news. Good news. I can remember my mother talking about her brother, Bob Richardson. Many of you may have known Bob. He was in Hawaii during the attack of Pearl Harbor, and they went forever without any news about Uncle Bob. Isn't that tough? And yet, finally, they received good news. He was able, you know, there was silence and a blackout where nobody was communicating, and finally he got word all the way back to the little community of Oakville that he was doing fine. Good news. You may have graduated, and isn't that good news to tell everybody, well, I've graduated from high school, I've graduated from college, or I have my MBA, or I have my doctorate. It's good news, I've graduated, or I passed the test. Good news. you may come home to the doctor and say, well, we're expecting good news. You may have come home from the doctor and say, we're not expecting good news. good news. Or the election's over. Good news. You know, good news. Well, Paul says several things about the gospel. Look what he says in verse 2 again. He tells us that it's promised in the Bible. It's promised. And he's talking about the Old Testament. He's not talking about the New Testament here. In Hebrews chapter 1, the first two verses, it says, in the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. In Luke chapter 24, verse 27, it says, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in scriptures concerning himself. So he was talking about the gospel, and it didn't just start in the New Testament. It was preached by Moses. It was preached by Abraham. It was preached by David. And we see it when we read scriptures. We find it in sacrifices. We find it in promises. We find it in predictions. The gospel was preached. And the prophets, you know, what did they do? What did they say in their message? He's coming. You remember all the, he's coming. Get ready, for Christ is coming. And they preached the gospel. And so the closer we get to the New Testament when we're reading, of course, it's clearer. It's revealed to us. And so, not, you know, it was a person. Now, that's my second point. It is a person. Let's look at verse 3. So let's read 1 through 3 again. I think it makes better sense to us if we read it in its entirety. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets, in the Holy Spirit regarding his Son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power. So, we see here that it is a person. That person is Jesus Christ. That's who Paul tells us it is. And see, you can take Buddha out of Buddhism, and you have a pretty good philosophy still. You can take Muhammad out of Islam, and you still have a decent system to live by. But when you take Jesus Christ out of Christianity, it falls apart. And the reason why is because everything is based on him. Christianity is not a religion. It is a relationship based with Jesus Christ. It's knowing that he is the Son of God. And that's what this gospel is about. And the reason why we know it's a person is because he says to human nature, it was a descendant of David. He's a human being. He had a human nature. You know, the Russian encyclopedia, and we don't read encyclopedias anymore because we just Google everything. But in the Russian encyclopedia, it says that Jesus Christ was a myth. Well, if he was, then it would be a religion again. And we'd have a relationship with a religion, but he was a human being. He had human nature. He did exist. We're told here that he was a descendant of David. All through the Old Testament, we're told that Jesus will come through the seed of David. And so if you turn to Matthew chapter 1 or Luke chapter 3, it lists two genealogies, and they don't necessarily match, but it shows to us that he came through the line of David, through the genealogy of Mary, and others through the genealogy of Joseph. But whether you come through Joseph or Mary, you'll find that Jesus was the Son of God. He was also the Son of, he was 100% God and 100% man. Now, it's important for us to understand this. Some have trouble with this. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who's been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin." So, had he not been wholly human, he could not have been an example for us. But if he couldn't die for us, then he wouldn't be able to comfort us. And so because he was 100% human, he went through the things that we go through and when we struggle. And we understand. I mean, he understands us. He understands this COVID-19 thing. You know, the way I look at some of this is, I don't know anything about leprosy, but yet when we read the Gospels, leprosy was one of the toughest things, and people had to be quarantined from it all the time. And when you saw somebody that had leprosy, they had to hide themselves and say, "Unclean, unclean." And then oftentimes they would have to go live in a community by themselves, quarantined totally by themselves. Well, our Lord understands. Because he was God and because he was human, he understands. He understands what we're going through today. This is a tough time. But he understands. Also, it's centered in the Son of God. Now, the gospel's promised in the Bible. It's a person, Jesus Christ, and it is centered in the Son of God. He's declared to be the Son of God, Paul says, by the resurrection from the dead. And that is so important for us to understand. Do we understand the importance of the resurrection? It's just so vital that we do. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 14, it says, "And if Christ had not been raised, our preaching would be useless, and so would your faith." So it's so important for us to understand that. And notice three things that he says here. Look at verse 4. "And who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with the power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our Lord." Now, Jesus Christ is our Lord. Jesus was his personal name. The Greek word here would be Joshua. It means Jehovah is salvation. Christ is his official name. The Greek word is Messiah, which means anointed. And then Lord is his title. Jesus Christ, our Lord, meaning master. He's our master. So it's promised in the Bible. It's a person, Jesus Christ. It's centered in the Son of God. And now, it is in the gospel of grace. Now, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time here with grace because you all know what's coming. We're going to spend a great deal of time. Paul spends a great deal of time on grace in the latter chapters. And when we get there, we'll talk about grace quite a bit. But we are going to talk about what grace means. So when we get there, we'll have an understand. Grace means God's riches at Christ's expense. Grace is everything God does for us because of Jesus. Grace is when you give someone what they need and not what they deserve. That's what grace is. And so the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ. The Son of Man and the Son of God is all about how God gives us what he wants and not what we need. That's what grace is. And then, it is a gospel for the whole world. Let's read verse 5 and 6. "Through him and for his name's sake, we receive grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ." So you see, in the Jewish mind, there were only two types of people, Jews and non-Jews. But Paul's saying the gospel is global. The gospel is for everybody. And that's why he wanted to travel so much. That's why he wanted to, you know, spread the gospel. He just really wanted to do that. So again, what can we say about Paul? Well, he was a servant. He was called. He was set apart. And we've looked at what the gospel is. What is the gospel? It's been in the Bible for hundreds of years. It's about a man, Jesus Christ, who's 100% God and 100% man. It's about God's grace and that the gospel is for everyone. So that's Paul's message. So now let's look at Paul's ministry. In verse 7, he says, "To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from Jesus Christ." So he refers to them as saints. You know, if I came in this morning, and oftentimes people will get up here and will say, "Good morning, church," or, you know, that. But if I said, "Good morning, saints," that would have been perfectly all right. That's what we are. We're all saints. Saint simply means one that belongs to Jesus Christ. And so it'd be fine, you know, if we called each other saints. And then he says, "Grace and peace." And, you know, that's just really a means of saying hello. Of course, he is writing a letter. But grace here, just when he's writing this letter, he's just really trying to convey to those that are reading this to just rejoice, be happy. And then, of course, peace is shalom, the Hebrew word, meaning peace. And then in verse 8, he starts with a compliment. A compliment. "First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world." I think when we try to develop good ministries, we have to be an encourager. We have to give compliments. You know, it's just so easy for us to be a critic. Anybody can be a critic. You know, we're pretty good at complaining. Paul didn't start out complaining at all. He says first, comma, and then he gives them a compliment. You know, it's just great. And it's great to know that they're Christians in Rome. I don't know how they got there exactly. I'm not sure. Paul did not start this church. But more than likely, this church did start from Paul's converts. You take folks like Priscilla and Aquila and others that he knew. If we turn to Romans 16, we can read a great list of converts that he lists that are there. And the church started to grow, even in Caesar's palace. It started to grow. And then notice the reputation of this church. Look at verse 8 again. "First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world." Now, they didn't have USA Today, and they didn't have email. They didn't have telegraph. They have telephone. They have anything. But yet Paul says, "Man, I want you to understand that you're known all over the world. Your reputation is awesome." And you know, the city of Rome was not an easy place to be a Christian. Nero was in charge, and he was king. The city was kind of corrupt. But you know, the more corrupt culture, it seems like the more Christians stand out. Let's have a show of hands this morning. How many have been inside Mammoth Cave? All right, great, awesome. When you went in, did they turn all the lights out on you? Now that's dark, isn't it? I mean, when you can't see the hand in front of you, that's dark. And then they turn a little light on. And isn't it amazing how that little bit of light illuminated the whole cave area where you could see again? I was just fascinated by that. Well, that's what Paul's talking about here. You know, Christians can go a long way. That light will shine. And you know, he says that your faith is being reported all over the world. Your reputation is just so wonderful. You know, for what do you think a church should be famous for? Its building, its size, its minister, music. Well, the church in Rome was noted for their faith. Their faith. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "We ought always to thank God for you, brothers and sisters, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love of all of you have for one another is increasing." So the church should be famous for its faith. It should be famous for its love. So what do you think our reputation is here at Franklin? We'll let that be a personal question right now. Have mask on, so I can't really read what you're thinking right back at me. And if you want to speak up, I would welcome that. That would be, what do you think unbelievers think about us? Or what does our brotherhood think about us? Well, you know, the church at Franklin is known for whatever you are. Wherever you are with your faith, and if people can associate that with Franklin, that's what people will think about Franklin. It's wherever you are. And if your faith is growing, and if your faith radiates love, and your faith radiates Christ-like things, and they'll know that. And the church is people, and whatever we are is what our reputation will be. That's what people will think about us. Well, why did the church in Rome have such a great reputation? Well, look at verse 9 through 10. "God, whom I serve in my spirit in preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness how constantly I remember you in my prayers at all times." See what Paul's saying? He's saying, I'm praying for you all the time. What kind of church do you think we'd be today if Paul prayed for us? I thought about that. Praying members make a great church. How often this past week did you remember this church in your prayers? How often did you remember us or you in Franklin? Well, see, we need to be a praying church. And what you need to understand here, Paul is praying for people he doesn't even know. He hadn't been there yet. He didn't know the entirety of its membership, yet he's praying for them. And so I'd like to challenge you to commit to praying to this church every day. Just offer prayers for its members. Now, in verse 10, it said, "In my prayers at all time, I pray that now, at least by God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you." You know, he wanted to be the one to come to help this church grow. And so, you know, we need to ask, "Lord, how can I be the answer to the prayers for this church? How can I give back, Lord?" Well, look at verse 11. "I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith." Mutually encouraged. He wanted to impart with them a spiritual gift. Now, the way I understand things, man is not the giver of spiritual gifts. The Holy Spirit is. If we look in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11, it says, "All of these are work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each just as he determines." So we all have gifts. But Paul meant that he wanted to impart, he wanted to share a spiritual gift. And I think that spiritual gift he's talking about here is the gift of teaching. I think he wanted to come and to help them and share the gospel with them. I think he intended to teach when he got there.
I think he wanted to make them strong. I think he wanted to help them be mutually encouraged. So if we summarize this section we just looked at, I think there's four things here that Paul's trying to do. First, I think he's trying to encourage people. I think he's trying to develop an attitude, a good attitude with people. So he complimented them. He said good things. He praised them. And then the second thing he did, he prayed for people. And then, you know, in verse 11, I like that little phrase, long to see you. You know, he was doing whatever he could to get to spend time with Christians. Are we doing that? Do we do our best to spend time with Christian folks? That's what Paul wanted to do. And then I also think Paul's trying to convince us to use our spiritual gift. We all have a spiritual gift. We've got some special gift that God gave us when we became a Christian, and we should use that gift to strengthen and encourage people. Now look at verse 13. Paul said, I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I plan many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I have had among other Gentiles. And basically what Paul's saying there is, I've been to all the other cities, the major cities in the Roman Empire, and I'm just really ready to come to you now. And I just can't hardly wait. So we've seen Paul the man, Paul's message, and that was the gospel. We've seen his ministry. So now let's look at Paul's motivation. Look at verse 14. I'm obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I'm so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. So what was Paul's attitude toward telling others about Christ? Well, if we look at the next three verses, Paul's going to list the I ams of Paul. And if you're one that likes to underline or make notes, and I have provided you with a binder, I think this is very important for us to hear what the I ams of Paul. Paul says, I'm obligated. I am obligated. Suppose this morning that you came in and last night you discovered a cure for COVID-19. Wouldn't you want to share it? Wouldn't you be compelled to share it so that everybody could be saved? Well, Paul says, I'm obligated. And I'm obligated to the lost people closest to you. In the book of Acts chapter 1, these are Christ's words. In verse 8, he says, but you will receive power from the Holy Spirit. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So, our family, our associates, people everywhere, I'm ready to share this gospel. I'm obligated. He said, I'm obligated to the Greeks. I'm obligated to the non-Greeks. I'm obligated, he said, to the cultured and to the not cultured, uncultured. And then in verse 15, he said, that is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. So it's not just enough to be obligated, he said. He said, I'm eager. I'm anxious. I'm willing. I have the passion. I'm totally committed. And you know, the greatest work you can ever do is to share the gospel with somebody. And then look what he says in verse 16. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. Paul says, I'm not ashamed. I am ready. I'm trained. This is my passion. He's bold. He's proud. He's ready to share this. Now, have you ever met a Christian that was ashamed of the gospel? Why were they ashamed? I don't know. You know, can we think of someone? Now, I really think the reason Paul was able to write this verse and really tell us that he's not ashamed, he said, I was in prison in Philippi. I was chased out of Thessalonica. I was smuggled out of Berea. I was laughed out of Athens. I was shipwrecked. I was beaten twice. I was left for dead. And that's why he can say, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I mean, he can boldly do, I am not ashamed. I am proud to be a Christian. He knows the greatness of it. And that's really the theme of his book. It's the power of God unto salvation is what he's talking about. For everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentiles. Look at verse 17. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Right relationship with God is by faith from first to last. And of course, Paul was quoting from the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 4. So if you want to be right with God, you live by faith. So these verses explain his attitude. I'm obligated to share it. I'm eager to share it. I'm not ashamed to share it. I've used up all my time this morning. But thank you all so much. We'll continue our study with verse 18 next week.